Salam students, let's begin with the today's class 8 session. We are doing political science. We have already started with our chapter number 6, understanding our criminal justice system. Children, today we are doing the third part of that chapter. We have already learned the content, and in content you have seen the introduction. In our last session, you have learnt about what is the role of the police in investigating a crime. And in today's session, you will be learning about the first information report. But before coming to the today's topic, children, just we will have the recap of what we have seen in the previous session. You all remember we have learnt about the fictional case in between the Shanti and Mrs. Shinde, right? After that case, you have seen that Article 22 of the Constitution has laid down. We have learned that in the role of the police in investigating a crime. Okay, what is that important function of the police in any complaint about the commission of a crime? Okay, then how he has to proceed with the investigation. It includes two processes, like recording statements of witnesses and then collecting different kinds of evidence. So on the basis of that investigation, the police are required to form an opinion. What opinion? Then they have to file a charge sheet in the court if, as per the evidence, they feel that the person is, accused person is guilty. So then they have to file a charge sheet in the court, right? Then the proceedings will begin in the court. But we have seen that also, it is not the job of the police to decide whether a person is guilty or innocent. But it is the judge who will decide whether the person is guilty or innocent, right? Then we have seen that Supreme Court has laid down some guidelines that the police must follow at the time of arrest, detention and interrogation, right? Then police are not allowed to torture or beat or shoot anyone during the investigation. And even they cannot inflict any form of punishment on a person, even for petty offenses. Then we saw the Article 22 of the Constitution and criminal law guarantee to every arrested person the following fundamental rights, right? We have learnt about that fundamental rights in our last session. What is that? The right to be informed at the time of arrest of the offence for which the person is being arrested. Then the second is the right to be presented before a magistrate within 24 hours of arrest, right? Then the right not to be ill-treated or tortured during arrest or in custody. Then the confessions made in public, in police custody, that cannot be used as evidence against the accused. Then the last we have seen, the boy under 15 years of age and woman cannot be called to the police station only for questioning. This is what we have learnt in the Article 22 of the Constitution, right? This is what you have learnt in that Article 22 of the Constitution, right? That has been given for the every arrested person, the fundamental rights need to be followed in that way, right? Now, the Supreme Court of India has laid down specific requirements and procedures that the police and the other agencies have to follow for the arrest, detention and interrogation of any person. Then these guidelines are known as the D.K. Basu's guidelines. And what are these D.K. Basu's guidelines and what is the need of it actually? Actually, D.K. Basu, it's from the West Bengal. There is a series of judgments that provide guidelines for handling police custodial violence. See, general law provides that convicts in custody should be treated with dignity. When any accused person is in the custody of the police, at that time the rules are to be followed. Why the need has been arrived? So that the significance of this is like the protection of fundamental rights. Otherwise, it has been seen like using force to inflict damage on life of an individual is a violation, right? We have learned that in our constitution. So this was done in the police custody. That is the reason the D.K. Basu's guidelines were required to stop that custodial violence. and even reduce the criminalization of police. Where? In the police station, when making provisions for guiding police actions, some criminalization of police force can be effectively controlled. Like in some segments, the police force have been involved in illegal activities, making use of their power to inflict damage on the society. So that is the reason the D.K. Basu's guidelines, Supreme Court of India gave that he let down that requirements and procedure that the police should follow when at the time of the arrest, detention and interrogation. Interrogation means you all know, while asking some questions to any of the person. So even for preventing the police custody torture, these are essential. These guidelines are essential. So the guidelines on custodial torture are very important in context of law and order of the state. And it is necessary that rules of fair treatment are followed while dispensing justice. Otherwise, it will be like if police will also not follow the requirement, the procedure that has been laid down for them, then it will be like even they are violating the laws, the rules of the society. That is the reason that was essential. Now let's see what were the guidelines that was given that were given by the Supreme Court of India for the police and the other agencies to follow. The first guideline was the police officials who carry out the arrest or interrogation. Interrogation means those who are arresting any of the person on the basis of the evidence, or those who are interrogating or like asking questions, should wear clear, accurate and visible identification. See how it is like when they wear the uniform, they should wear the clear, accurate and the visible identification and the name tags. You have seen the uniform of the police, they have the name tags, and even as per the designation they have that stars. So all these things should be clearly visible on their uniform, right? So the as per the designation of that policeman, the name tags and everything should be visible properly on the uniform of that police official. Like they should carry out at the time of arrest, or when they are asking some questions, they are interrogating someone, at that time they should wear the clear, accurate and visible identification and name tags with their designation. So this is one of the important guidelines that has been given by D.K. Basu. Okay, let's move to the next one. The memo of arrest should be prepared at the time of arrest and should include the time and date of arrest. A memo should be prepared at the time of arresting. Okay, and what it should include? The time and the date of arrest. It should also be attested by at least one witness. One witness means the person who has seen that incident, first-hand account. Okay, he is going to be the first-hand person who is going to tell about the incident that had happened, who could include a family member of the person arrested. Okay, and the arrest memo should be countersigned by the person arrested. It should be signed by the arrested person also. The person arrested, the third guideline is, the person arrested, detained or being interrogated has a right to inform a relative, friend or well-wisher. It means the person who has been arrested should, if he wish to inform any of their close friends or relatives or any well-wisher from whom he can expect some help, he has that right to do that, okay? And the fourth one is, when a friend or relative lives outside the district, it means not in the district, the time, the place of arrest and the venue of custody must be notified by police within 8 to 12 hours after arrest. Suppose the person on which the police feels like he has done some crime, okay, and they want to arrest. And if that person is not in the district, okay, he has gone somewhere out and he has been arrested from that district. So the time, the place of arrest and the venue of custody all must be notified by police within 8 to 12 hours after arrest. Okay, So the person actually doesn't belong to that the particular district, but then too he has been arrested from some outside district. So all that details need to be written by the police officials, okay? And even a friend or and even the person who has been arrested should know all these details very well. So this is what the DK Basu guidelines to be followed, okay? But actually speaking, if we'll talk something in practically, like when Shanti was arrested, Shanti's case, you all remembered it very well, right? In that we have seen when she was arrested for theft, Sub-Inspector Rao also kept her brother Sushil in the police locker for 2 days. This is what you have seen in the fictional case. Was it legal for the police to detain him? Actually, was it legal? Does it violate the DK Basu guidelines? Yes, definitely it violates. So did Sub-Inspector Rao do enough to question witnesses and compile evidence before arresting Shanti and filing a case against her? So in keeping this with the duties of the police as stated above, what else do you think like Sub-Inspector Rao could have done as a part of his investigation? That is the reason these guidelines have to be followed strictly by the police officials. Okay. Now after that, the next topic, children, that you are going to see here is FIR, that is First Information Report. Now what is it? It is with the registration of an FIR. See, unless and until the FIR has not been filed, it has not been registered with the police, then the police cannot begin their investigation. Okay, it is with the registration of an FIR that the police can begin their investigations into a crime. Okay, that is the reason you have seen many of the movies and even the programs, and you have heard about this. Whenever the person goes to the police officers, they ask them to file an FIR first, right? That is the reason without FIR, without registering an FIR, police cannot begin their work. They cannot do the investigation what had happened as the crime. Okay, so that is must. The law states that it is compulsory for an officer in charge of a police station to register an FIR. What is that? The law states that it is compulsory for an officer in charge of a police station to register an FIR whenever a person gives information about a cognizable offense. Now, what is the meaning of that cognizable offense? The very first before coming to the meaning of that, try to understand what the law states there. It is compulsory what for an officer who is on duty, who is in charge of the police station, to register an FIR whenever a person gives information about a cognizable offense. Now, let's move to the meaning of that cognizable. What is that? Now let's understand the meaning of the term cognizable. What is that? Cognizable means, in the context of this chapter, this refers to an offense for which the police may arrest a person without the permission of the court. See, if the police officers, they feel the crime that the person has done, he should be arrested for that without the permission of the court also. That is called as the cognizable offense, okay? For which the police doesn't have to wait for the permission from the court. Okay, some cases, some offenses are cognizable and some are non-cognizable. So in cognizable, there is no need for the police before arresting a person to take the permission of the court. Okay, now this information can be given to the police either orally or in writing. Okay, it can be done orally or as well as in writing also. The FIR usually mentions, now what is the content of the FIR, children, go to that. It mentions the date, time and place of the offense. Even it gives you the details, the basic facts of the offense. First of all, it mentions the date when that crime had happened, time when that FIR has been registered, date, time and the place of the offense. And even the details or the basic facts of the offense, some evidences that has been got by the police, including a description of the events. Even the description will also be given related to that. So all these things FIR includes, okay? Then if known, The identity of the accused persons and witnesses is also mentioned. If the identity of the accused person is known and the witnesses, those who have seen that incident, okay, even for them also it can be mentioned in that FIR. And FIR also states the name and the address of the complainant. The person who has given the complaint, the FIR states the name of that person as well as the address of that complainant. There is a prescribed form has been given for this, in which the police registers an FIR and it is signed by the complainant. See, they have got that fixed format of that FIR with the date, timing, everything will be given in that, and all the details will be filled accordingly. And after filling all the details of the prescribed form, it should be signed by the complainant. Then the complainant also has a legal right to get a free copy of the FIR from the police. It is like if anybody has not got it, they can ask directly to the police officials to give it to them. And even that is, they are not going to pay anything for that. It is free of cost for the complainant to have the legal, this is a legal right. It has been given in our constitution also, to get the free copy of the FIR from the police. So this is what, children, you have learnt about the FIR. Okay, so in today's session, we have learnt about the D.K. Basu's guidelines that has been led by the Supreme Court of India. And then we have seen about the first information report, that is FIR. Why it is essential and what are the requirements and what are the details to be filled in an FIR. This is what you all have learnt in the today's session. Okay. So children, see you in the next session with the remaining topic, that is what is the role of the public prosecutor, role of the judge, that we will be learning in the next session. Till then, children, go through this session and go through the slides, whatever is given related to the FIR, understand it properly and try to read the chapter and write the important points of that. So see you in the next session with the next topic. Till then, children, take care.